Students have won the 2005, 2009, 2010, 2012 Fringe Best Solo Show Award, all kinds of awards. They've got book deals, movie deals, representation. Most often they're actors, right? But there's many writers who are also doing it. So over that time, my class has changed. And I, like I said, I really believe my goal is not to have everybody do the same solo. There isn't like a Matt Hoverman solo show. But I really do think that there are certain principles I've learned that help you avoid certain pitfalls and to make your solo show really pop. So the first thing I wanted to talk about is...
And you said there were that you're emailing the notes or whatever.
No, I have.
These people are about to
oh yeah, don't write any of this down because I'm going to hand out a 6-page thing that has everything I say written really clearly for you, so you can just experience this class. So what we're going to do is I'm going to talk to you just for a little while, and then we're going to talk about one of the elements of what makes a great solo show, and then you guys are going to rehearse and perform 90-second solo shows.
Wow. Right?
So like I said, there's the two basic building blocks of solo shows. To me, are telling your own story, performing as another character. Okay, and there are, as I said, there's many different combinations. Eric Bogosian, in the course of a show, will tell stories kind of from his life. He'll do characters. Some of those characters are aspects of his personality. Some of them are just kind of rants.
Are the door guy?
Yeah. Oh, no. You have to come in. You can just come in. Don't worry about it. Just come and sit down.
Invade.
Yes, invade. And there's many different ways of performing them, but today we're going to focus on the autobiographical story, solo show. Yes? Oh, you're scratching your ear. Okay. So I would like to ask a couple people what your goals would be for doing a solo show. Just one goal of doing a solo show. Just raise your hands.
I would like to get a story that I've had marinating out in some form, and
fantastic.
That might inspire me to do that.
Great. How about somebody else? A goal for doing a solo show.
Yeah. Make the audience
laugh. Make the audience laugh. Yeah.
Make the audience identify.
Fantastic.
I would like to touch people in certain ways.
Wonderful. You mean like sexual?
No.
These are really wonderful, noble goals. It's also okay to have professional goals, you know.
Well, for me, I think it's okay to be different.
Yes. And you know, I'm really glad you said that, because a lot of people who do solo shows, especially our actors who are not the traditional types, and that's true also for people just telling their own stories. And the great example is Whoopi Goldberg, somebody said, John Leguizamo was only getting cast as drug dealers and pimps, so he started creating, he started doing characters that showed that Latino men could do other things. All of a sudden, there's movies with leading roles for Latino men. Where were they before, right? He created that need. Cameron Manheim, did a solo show. She was a heavy actress. You guys remember her from The Office? She did a solo show called Wake Up, I'm Fat. And it was all about her really claiming, you know, being an overweight actress. And not only did she get that amazing part in The Practice, but that part of The Practice became, became a mouthpiece for the issues she raised in her show. Billy Bob Thornton, I don't know if you guys know this, but Sling Blade was actually started as a solo show. And what happened was, he was an actor who wasn't doing very well. His friends were all getting work. He was doing this horrible, like, Twilight Zone knockoff. He was in the dressing room, like, waiting to go on. He was playing the conductor on a phantom train. So he had this, like, blue shirt, like, up to here, this weird haircut and, like, powder on his face. And he just started making faces at himself in the mirror. And he just went, ugh. He was just like, you're terrible, and no one wants you. And as he started doing this, his face started going, my lack, where you gone? And then this monologue just came out. And that he started by doing that as a solo show, then it was a short film, then it became a full-length film, and then he won the Oscar for it.
Wait,
a huge
what
career.
Sling
Blade.
Sling Blade.
A great film. So so a lot of times these, Nia Vardalos is the last one, she's Greek, and she was trying to be an actress in LA, and they kept saying, you're ethnic, but you're not the right kind of ethnic. And we don't know what to do with you. So she created a solo show called My Big Fat Greek Wedding. And Tom Hanks and his wife came and saw it, optioned it, and became one of the largest, biggest grossing independent films of all time. So for people who say like, oh, your personal story, your own story, is not really gonna do anything for you, it will do amazing things for you. For your career, for getting a message out about a particular ethnic group or just being, it's often the people who do solo shows are the people who feel like they don't fit in. And so they're like, instead of trying to fit into the world of other people, they're creating their own world and saying, world, look at me, this is it. They're creating a place for them in the world. And also, often it's having your say, like getting that story out. So those are great goals. Now, what are fears people have with solo shows? And you said?
My fear is it's about me, that it's going to be like self-masturbatory.
Yes, yes.
I'm like, who cares?
Right, exactly, yeah. You'll be, everybody, you'll be crying on stage, bleeding all over them, and everyone will be like, when do we get out? Right? And have we all seen solo shows like this?
Yes,
right? And they're terrible, and they make us want to run from ever seeing another solo show. Yes. What are other fears of doing a solo show?
I fear that my life is just not interesting.
Right, I'm not interesting, yeah.
Yeah. Memorizing half an hour.
Yes. And similar to that, does anyone have a fear of not finishing it? Like I'll start it and I'll get overwhelmed, or I'll just like, it'll be one more project that I don't get interested, that I don't finish yet.
Sharing the thing you know you should share, that right. You're going to just hurt and humiliate your family.
And then you won't be loved by anyone anymore.
Yeah.
People closest to you will reject you forever, absolutely. Yeah.
Being overwhelmed by the emotions that you're...
Right, right. I love that I asked for goals and there was like one goal, and then I asked for fears and there was like a
hurting those in your life.
Yeah, hurting those in your life and alienating them. Okay, I'm going to stop there. Let's not let the fear overtake the room. So I always ask this question at the beginning of class, and the number one fear people have is, it's going to be boring. I don't have a story to tell. It's just going to be me jerking off on stage. I'm going to be feeling all these feelings and no one else is going to care at all, right? And again, if we've seen shows like this, so we have a very visceral experience of that. So I got a couple things to say about that. One is, because you are living, your stories have been in your head for 20, 30, 40, 50, 60 years, you think they're boring because you've just been living with them for so long. But they're actually interesting to other people. And I will give you an example of the madness that we have about this. In one of my first classes, I had the student, and she, in my class, the first assignment is to tell your whole life story in a page. And the story that she told was, she was growing up in New Zealand, and she was the only Catholic in an all-Protestant school. And there was this Protestant girl gang, and they beat her up every day, and eventually brought a gun to school and shot her. And then she was befriended by the female shot putter on the team, who's this like gigantic, super strong woman, who beat up the entire gang and scared them away, and she was never bothered again. So she told us this story, and we were like, that would make a pretty good solo show, right? And she said, I don't know, I think people will think it's boring. I'd rather do a show that's funny observations about New York. And that's where you see the madness that we all have. Because we often think that the thing that we're not interesting, but other people are. Okay, so it does take courage to go into this. The other thing about that is, do you guys at least buy that could be true, that you have interesting stories in you?
Yes.
The other thing is, there's a lot, and also I'll just say this. There's a lot of shaming that goes on in the arts around doing your own story. You know, it's like, don't write about what you know. Write about characters you have no idea about. And there's nothing wrong with that. That's fantastic. But it really is okay to write about the things that you do know and the things that scare you about what you know. I think when people say don't write about what you know, what they mean is don't write about things that you already have answers for. Write about the things that you have questions about. But it comes from you. And a lot of times what we do as artists is the first thing we do is deny who we are, and then we try to create something based on what we think other people think is cool. Yeah, you with me so far? Okay. So the other thing I want to say about it is this fear of being emotionally overwhelmed or of making the audience uncomfortable is that I'm going to be up there, I'm going to start talking about the way my father molested me when I was 6, and I will start crying so hard that I won't be able to stop, and the audience will get really uncomfortable, and I'll feel really ashamed afterwards. And that will probably happen. The first thing I'll say about it is, it has a lot to do with your intent. Why you're doing the solo show. If you're doing the solo show to get empathy or sympathy or the love that your parents were never able to provide, much like mine, we will sense that, right? We can sense that you're like telling us the story because you want us to heal you. If you're doing that, it will put people off. It will be a show like that. But if you come from a place of, I have gone through this, yes, it's a difficult, scary thing that I've dealt with, but I'm okay with the emotion. And that I'm gonna give you a gift about it. Not necessarily this sort of like Pollyanna-ish, here's the lesson of how you deal with molestation, you know, but but something that I got through this, and here's something, I'm doing this for you, okay? Now, there's a process to that, and along the way to that process, you will start crying so hard you can't stop. And the first time you perform the show, you might be overwhelmed by feelings at moments. But one of the principles, but first of all, you will get better at that, and eventually you'll have a different problem. If you keep performing the show, that thing about your father touching you the way you shouldn't have will stop, it'll be like a, you know, like a pocket of gas, it'll eventually empty out, and then you'll talk about it and you'll have no feeling about it. And then you'll have to be like an actor doing emotional substitution for your own life story. And then you'll be like, God, if only I was moved to tears by this still, you know. And I was going to say one more thing about that. And also, the principles that we talk about will be the structure that carries you along so you won't get overwhelmed by it. Doing a solo show about your life is kind of like, you guys know what a plane is, where you like plane a door? Mm-hmm. It's like, it's a little sled, little metal sled that has a dial on it with a blade, and you dial the depth of the blade, right? And just like with your life, you know, if you dial it too deep, the plane gets stuck in the door. If you dial it too light, it just sort of skims off the top. It's the same way with your autobiography. You want to go deep enough that you get something real, but you don't want to go so deep you get stuck in it, and you don't want to go so shallow that you just kind of rebound off of nothing. And then this is something else I'm going to say. No, I'm going to say this other thing first. I love what you said, you know, people are talking about, like, what if I bring up something so scary or something so damaging to my family that they won't love me anymore, which is really the fear that we all have, I think, about art in general. And I think this is actually a really great thing to confront in a solo show as an artist, because I'll tell you another story. I had this student, first of all, let me just say, if somebody did bad stuff to you, you own that experience. If they wanted to be written about better, they should have treated you better. And my wife was actually at another writing teacher was talking, and somebody said, how do you find, when do you know you found your voice? And she said, when what you're writing upsets your parents. second thing is, don't invite them. unless your parents are famous, you know, no one's gonna know who they are. You can change names and stuff like that. But the first draft through should be the truth. It should be your truth. And here's an example. So I have a student named Michelle Glick, and she was half Asian. She was her mother was a Vietnamese war bride, and her dad was this white redneck Alabama guy who met her when he was in the military. So she grew up Asian, half Asian, in this rural South, and there were no other Asian kids around. But because she was half Asian, she really could kind of pass, or so she thought. So she was like, I don't know, 8 years old or whatever, and they were doing a production of Annie, and she really wanted to be one of the orphans. She's like, I know I'm not a redhead, I won't get any, but I want to be one of the orphans. So the day came for them to announce all the parts, and she said they got to her name, and they said, Michelle Glick, Oriental Chauffeur. Oh. And it was just like, she said, time just stopped in that moment. It's like, Oriental. And it was when she suddenly realized, like, she was not passing. That everybody saw her that way. And so she told this story in my first level one class, and she said, I can't do it. And we were all like, do your show about that. Do your show about growing up Asian in the South, right? And she's like, I can't do it. So she did a safer choice. She did a solo show about her funny wedding with some funny characters in it, and it was good. It was okay. And she did it, it went well. And she applied to some festivals, and she didn't get in. And then she came back and took the class again, and she said, okay, I'm ready to tell this story now. And it was like every class she came to, it was a different, it was like there was a whole other person there. The power that came out of her, funny, moving, like smart. I mean, it was just this like, it was another person. She did that show, she applied to a festival, she got in like the next day. The show got incredible reviews, she won an award, she's taking the show to Berlin now. You know, it's often, there was recently a documentary made about my class, and if you email me, and my email's there, I will send you a link to it. And it's all about how it's usually the thing that you don't want to do your show about is that's what you should do your show about. Everybody with me so far? All right. Terrified yet? here's the other thing. It's like, it's not the content of your show that makes a solo show, autobiographical solo show, good or bad. I'm going to say that again. It is not the content of your solo show that makes it good or bad. It's not, because I have seen wonderful solo shows about somebody's mother dying. I have seen terrible solo shows about somebody's mother dying. It's not the mother dying that makes the show good or bad. It's these principles that we are now going to talk about. Okay, these principles that are going to help you create a wonderful solo show. And for those of you who arrived late, I'm going to give you a little packet at the end of this. It's everything I say written down so you can just sort of experience it. You can take notes if you want. But, the three principles of a great solo show, the autobiographical solo show, according to Matt Hoverman, and you should listen to me, are a really strong story, a clear persona, and a clearly stated theme. Okay, we're going to talk mostly about story today. Persona is, just because we're not going to be able to talk about this, is the persona is the version of you that you perform. Okay, there's something about the way the human brain is wired, where we see everybody else's distinct characters. Like, oh, he's such a joker, and she's such a slut, and you know, she's so uptight, right? We have these things about other people, but when we describe ourselves, we say, oh, well, I'm shy, except when I'm proud, except when I'm strong, except when I'm religious, except on Saturday night when I get a little frisky, right? We like see ourselves as endlessly complex, and that, if you present that person to the audience, we'll have no idea who's taking this journey that you're on. So it's deciding what aspect of myself am I going to accentuate, a simplified version of myself. And a great, but it has to be truthful. So a great example of this, great place to go to for this, are stand-up comics. Woody Allen actually started as a stand-up comic. What is his persona? Right, and we all know, right? We all know what it is immediately. Roseanne Barr, what was her?
Sarcastic
Brassi. And she would actually say it in her act. She'd say, I'm a domestic goddess. Okay, that's her persona, right? The working class, outspoken person. Larry the Cable Guy. He's the cable guy. It's in his name. He's the guy who comes and fixes your cable, right? So, going way too far down this road, but anyway, do you guys know who Jack Benny is? Any of you?
Yeah.
Jack Benny. I used to go, you know who Jack Benny is? He's like Johnny Carson, and now my students go, who's Johnny Carson? right, exactly. So, Jack Benny, the one thing everybody knew about him was?
Talk what?
Cheap. Yeah. Yes, exactly. He was cheap. So there was this famous sketch where he was like a radio person and film and TV personality, and he was walking down a dark alley, and a crook came up behind him and said, "All right, buddy, your money, your life." And he paused, and everybody laughed, and then he said, "Well," and he says, "I'm thinking," and that got a laugh too. That second laugh is the punchline, but the first laugh is the persona laugh, because who he is so clear in our minds. All he has to do is this, and we know what he's thinking. Okay, so that's persona. That's all I'm going to talk about today. But we're going to talk about story. But before we do that, great here. I'm going to talk a little bit about my philosophy of creating a solo show. And the first thing is, your perfect solo show already exists inside of you. Your perfect solo show already exists. It's not about coming up with something smart or political or what people are looking for, okay? There's something in you that's calling to be born. And your job is not to create it, but to sit by the burbling brook of your creativity and listen. Okay? So the other thing is, we're not really gonna do much feedback in this class, but we don't give negative feedback in my class. We just say what works and if we have questions, okay? We don't rewrite each other's shows. Because it's very scary doing this work, and you're really tender sapling. You know, you're really just seeds beginning at the beginning, and it's very easy to get crushed and told that isn't interesting or something like that. So it's very important as you're doing this work to find believing mirrors to be with each other. You know, people who are taking the risk too. Some people miss the criticism, you know, and so if you want, you can stay after for $5, I'll insult you. So here we go. So at the beginning of every class, we do a little meditation and a little stretching warm-up, because it is a performance, it's a writing for performance class. So the meditation is, I don't have any particular religious agenda with the meditation. But you all will be Scientologists by the end of this class. So just close your eyes, say whatever way you want. Your spine's tall, the pride of this class. And a nice inhale. and an exhale. And an inhale, and an exhale. And as you continue to breathe, you can just let natural flow of breathing. As you inhale, breathe in the knowledge that whatever show, story you wind up telling today is the exact right story. And exhale out fear, worry, self-doubt, and usage. And inhale the knowledge that you are enough. And exhale out all those voices that tell us that we're not enough. We're not smart enough, or good enough, or funny enough, or whatever. Just breathe in light, air, and support. And breathe out the junk. Time and hang.
Good. We're going to do that again this time, bobbling the knees and shaking the sound out. Inhale. Floating up your.
All three. And then go the other way. Okay, letting that go. Feet together. This is the most dangerous part. Feet together, hands on your knees. Watch me do it before you do it, because I don't want you to hurt yourself. You're going to rotate around, and you're going to say this in a high-pitched, silly English voice, okay? Around, and around, and around, whoosh back! Off you go.
Around, and around, and around, whoosh back!
Very good. Then we're going to go the other way, and we're going to say, wait, wait, don't hurt yourself.
The other way, around, whoosh back!
Off you go.
The
park yourself around the block. Conversation about story. And let's begin by, I'm going to ask you guys, when do we tell stories in our society? And for what purpose?
Around the campfire.
Around the campfire. What else?
Get something off your chest.
To get something off your chest. There's no wrong answers. Nothing is stupid.
Story.
That's stupid.
Get advice.
To get advice, yes.
Gossip,
yes.
When you're telling a lie.
When you're telling a lie, fantastic. When you're drunk, yes. Right?
I love it.
What?
When you're teaching.
When you're teaching, exactly.
When you're alone to yourself.
When you're introducing yourself, when you're
alone to yourself.
Yes. Clearly a solo show. To seduce, right? Politicians use it, you were saying, to lie, right? Right. And what are some of those sort of those occasions where we tell stories?
Dinner parties.
Weddings, right?
Or in your room.
Dates, right? Yes.
Waiting in line.
Funerals, right? So you're constantly telling and hearing stories all the time. You guys have really heard and told thousands of stories in your life. So you're all actually experts already in telling a great story. Class is over. No! All right, that would be so mean. Okay. What makes a bad story?
Feeling sorry for yourself when you're telling it.
Fantastic.
Goes on and on.
Right.
Have you heard it 5,000 times before?
Thank you. You know my mother.
Complaining.
Complaining, yeah.
Looking for compliments, fishing for compliments.
Yes.
It's about nothing.
It's about nothing. Let's move sort of into more structural things, like what makes a poor story, yeah.
No conflict.
No, oh, I love those words, yes. Now, I know this room, there's people here who are very experienced with playwriting and some people who are less, so if some of this right now, for the next few minutes, seems a little bit like you've heard it before, just go with it. It's going to get interesting again really quickly. Okay, yes. Conflict, yes. What else?
No resolution.
No resolution, yes.
No humor.
Nobody changes,
right, great.
No.
You don't take the audience into account.
Exactly.
No rising action.
Oh, you guys know all of this. Fantastic. All right. So, what makes a good story?
Conflict.
Well, what is conflict? What is
conflict? The unknown of not how it's going to wrap up and finish.
Suspense, yes.
Suspense.
What creates conflict?
Opposing needs.
What you want. What you
fantastic. Everybody move over to this side of the space. Mm-hmm. We're now going to see a performance by Katie Atchison, my wife. Over there. Yeah, my wife. Okay, just watch this. Well, no. It's gonna take five seconds. Go over there.
Okay.
Well, first of all, so a story. We often use words like journey and stuff for story, right? So we said opposing forces. So I'm gonna posit that a story is about somebody who wants something, right? What do we call the person who wants something in a story?
The
protagonist or hero. And how do we know who they are?
Good looking.
Thank you!
Go on the journey.
They're the one who has the biggest need, right? They go on that journey. What do we know about the thing they want?
We all want it.
It's hard to get. There's obstacles.
Yes, fantastic. Well, you're way ahead of me, but it's something specific is what I was looking for. So this is, so Katie, go ahead, do your performance piece. Let's give her a round of applause, everybody. Very nice. Okay, is that a story?
No.
There was a hero, yes?
Heroin,
yes. Did she want something?
We didn't know what she wanted.
No. Well, what did she do?
Was the story about the woman that crossed the room?
Yes, she wanted to get across the room, right? Did she accomplish her goal?
Yes.
Was it a satisfying story?
No.
No, horrible. Katie, what's your doing? Okay. Go back. All right. Between what you want and the obstacles you face is conflict, and that's the essence of drama and story, okay? Now this seems really basic, right? We all know this. Then we apply it to our own lives, and something weird happens, okay? Because there's something about the way the human brain is wired where we see other people, just like we see other people as distinct characters, we tend to see other people as active. They're doing things all the time, right? You know, that guy at work, he's just so pushy, he's always like trying to get ahead, or this person's that way. But when we think of ourselves, I'm just a good person. Trying to make it in a world that keeps doing things to me, right? So that's how we kind of perceive ourselves passively, victims, right? And that's what often leads to the kind of shows that we were talking about, which is a tale of things that happened to me, versus this is something I wanted and went out. It makes sense, right? Mm-hmm. So what we do in my class is we drill this over and over and over again because it takes time to really look at what did I want in that situation, because we don't often admit it to ourselves that we want something, right? I'm just a good person, I'm just trying to be nice. Even if you're trying to be nice, what is it that you want?
Your
To be liked, right? To be respected by somebody or to be liked. Yeah, it's hard. See that pause there? It's hard to admit sometimes that that's what we really wanted. So a lot of the autobiographical work is really being honest with what it is that we wanted, what it is that we were going for. And it doesn't have to be a positive thing, okay? So a story, and I'll say the other thing about it is that one of the big traps that people fall into is with autobiographical solo shows is they go, oh, and I'm sure you've seen this one, oh, it's a solo show about me, about my life. Here's how it goes. I was born in Cleveland. And then I got polio. And then my parents got divorced. And then I met Bruce Willis. And then I fell in love for the first time. And then I moved to California, right? And you're just going, what is your response as an audience? Shoot me now, right? Because it's all the things they did in their life. I call that the and then what happened is solo show, right? So you know how in often by biopics, movies about somebody famous, usually the performance is really good, but the movie itself is not a great movie because it's episodic and they just kind of do all the things in that person's life. My favorite biopic is Walk the Line, because it doesn't present his whole life, right? It's about one thing that he wants and going after, and what is that thing?
Jill.
He wants her to marry him, right? And when does the movie end?
When she does.
When she says yes. It's literally he says, "Well, I'm not gonna play this song until you say yes." No, 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 no. Yes. They kiss. Everybody applauds. Freeze frame. Credits roll. Have you guys seen shows where you felt like it ended and they just kept talking?
Yes.
Right? Okay, good. So your want is the contract you make with the audience where you say, okay guys, we're gonna climb to the top of Mount Everest and you're all gonna come with me. And I'm gonna clearly define this. If I get to the top of Mount Everest and say, and now we're gonna purchase a new car together, right, you're ready, you're gone. So a great story is about somebody who wants something, who actively goes after it. I had one student who did a funny thing. He said, I'm not good with goals. He goes, I'm good with goals, I'm just not good at going after them. He goes, I'm good at naming a goal, and I will just sit here on this couch until I achieve it. So we're attracted to characters who go after things, who want things. Richard III, terrible human being, but he goes after things, and we enjoy watching him, right? Mm-hmm. So it's looking for the times in your life where you went after something. Experienced obstacles, and in the end, you either get it or you don't. Do all great stories end with somebody getting what they want?
No.
If they don't, what makes them satisfying?
They learn something.
Okay.
They want something else.
They die.
They change.
Yeah, great, they die. Right, is this a satisfying story? I've always wanted to climb Mount Everest. And I spent years training and saving up, and I got 200 yards from the top, and I slipped and I broke my leg. Kurt. Is that a satisfying story?
No.
No, it's a terrible story, right? So what might make that a more interesting story?
That we realize, that he realizes that getting to the top is not the thing that he
wanted.
That the audience realizes that he realizes that what he thought he wanted isn't what he actually wanted.
Right. So beautiful. And the way I like to say this is, to paraphrase a certain rock group, sometimes you can't get what you want, but you can get what you
need.
Right. So it could be something like this. I'm an asshole persona, right? I'm an asshole. I've always been an asshole. I'm out for number one. And you know what? One of the things about being number one is I'm going to climb the biggest fucking mountain in the world. So I had this goal that I was going to climb that Mount Everest. And I all the way up, I was passing people. People were passing out. Fuck them. I'm like on my way to the top. I'm 200 yards from the top, and this little Chinese girl is stranded on this ledge. And this storm is coming, and I have a choice to get to the top and take my picture and show the world I'm number fucking one, or save this bitch. And I save her and I go down. Is that satisfying?
Yes.
Yeah. Right, because I thought I wanted.
To reach the top.
Yeah, to achieve. And what I realized I needed was.
To change.
To save somebody.
To care about somebody.
To care about somebody.
Right. My favorite example of this is the movie. By John Cusack called The Sure Thing. Are you guys aware of this movie?
Yeah.
Right, it's a movie from the 80s. I don't even know if this is really the movie. It could just be how I remember it. But in the movie, John Cusack, we're moving on, you guys doing your stuff. John Cusack, he's a virgin, he's like lives in the Northeast. He meets this girl, sexy hot blonde, she's in LA. And he knows if he can just get to her, she will have sex with him. She is the sure thing. So for some reason he can't fly because it's a movie, and he has to somehow get his way across the country. So of course he starts traveling with
his friends.
Best friend girl.
Yes. Well, a girl who he hates. She's a brunette, she's smart, she's feisty, they fight the whole way, she's anal. What happens when they get to LA?
She's anal.
They have anal, yes. Thank you. Hello, Internet!
He realizes that he really loves her.
And right, and he doesn't. So he thought he wanted.
The sure thing.
Yeah. Thought he wanted.
The hot blonde.
Sex, and what he realized he needed was.
Shame.
That's a solo show I'd like to see. This is often the structure of an autobiographical solo show. There's many things that we've gone for in our lives that we didn't get, right? Those are the times that really test us. Those are the times where that change us. I mean, it's great to tell a story about, like, I really wanted this part, and God damn it, I got it. You know, yay for you, right? Yeah. But that thing of I really wanted this thing. I wanted to keep my mother from dying, and she died. Right? But I learned what, or I realized, or I changed in what way. So that is often the structure of an autobiographical solo show. Make sense? Mm-hmm. The last thing I wanted to say about this is, you guys, how many people like or write musicals? I know there's a musical theater actors here. Yeah, there you are. So in the classic musical structure, the first song is kind of always sets the scene, right? And the second song usually is the I want song, okay? It's when the hero comes out, or heroine, and they sing about what they want. And they make it clear, distinct, and not only that, they really sing about it, okay? So in Annie, the first song is, I think it's a hard enough life, right? And what are they communicating in that song?
It's a
shitty in the orphanage, right? And then she comes out and she sings what?
Maybe.
Maybe. And what is she singing? Maybe far away or maybe real nearby. He'll be either pouring her coffee, she'll be there straightening his tie. What is she singing about?
Her parents.
What does she want? She wants to find her parents, right? How do you feel by the end of that song?
You're really, really rooting for her.
Right. You want her to have, you fall in love with her goal, right? You get on board with this train that's leaving the station. If she were to come out and say, you know, I'd really like to meet my parents, and the play begins, would you be as engaged?
No.
You as a solo show person can sing an I want song. I don't mean you have to sing it, but you paint a picture for us of what this goal you think will give you. That's where you really hook us. Okay, and then that's an agreement that you make, and then when you get it or you don't get it, what happens? It's over. It ends. Right. Yes. Good. Okay. Fantastic. There's different kinds of conflict, and because of time, I don't want to get too much into it. Basically, external versus internal conflict. External conflict is when we're fighting the elements or other people, and internal conflict is when we fight. What kind of obstacles do we find in ourselves?
Self-doubt.
Yeah.
Pride.
Lust, procrastination, addiction, fear, right? And often a solo show is about a story where I had to fight this person and that person and the rain and to get what I wanted, and then at the last minute I had to face myself. Okay, and that's the thing. So there is this sort of paradox about, many paradoxes about solo show, but one of them is, you know, we've come to see you. We really want to see something personal and, you know, something that's dangerous for you to talk about. At the same time, we want you to be okay with it. And I promise you, if your story has these elements that I'm talking about, it will be a story that gives the audience something versus just looking for empathy for the things that were done to you. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So what we're going to do now is you guys are going to rehearse and perform a 90-second solo show together. So pair up and just go all throughout the room.
Together.
Yes. Yeah. So just pair up in twos and just stand somewhere in the room. You can be somebody you know, somebody you don't know. Don't be shy.
Oh my.
Okay, everybody got a partner?
You're not doing it.
Everybody has to participate. Nobody's sitting out. Okay. There's lots of room over here if you want to sit down.
Yeah, but I'm not a performer.
Doesn't matter. Doesn't matter if you're not a performer. second. Does everybody have a partner? Is there anybody who's on?
No.
You guys don't have partners? There's three of you?
No.
Well, Hector and Shubert.
You guys don't want to do it? What's wrong?
No, I want
to. So you guys partner, and you're two partner. Get up.
Oh. Come on. Two stage people together.
It's fun. You guys want to partner? Guys, there's some of the best solo shows that I've ever seen, that I've ever helped, that people who have never written or acted before in their lives. If you are a human being on the planet, you have a story to tell. Okay? And everybody's doing it in this room, except for me. So we're all risking together. Okay.
And her, except for
me. And her,
she's
yes.
Doing it
well, she's taking
I am.
She's taking photographs. She's documenting. Yeah, that's okay.
So Matt, yes. One of us performs it.
Well, No, we're not writing it. I'm going to take you through a process, okay? So decide between you. Everybody focus on me for a second. Everybody decide between you who's A and who's B. Okay. Okay. That doesn't require that much talking. Stop. Guys, we have a lot to get through. So if I'm gonna get, guys, we're gonna have a lot to get through, and I know you're all fascinating people, but I want you to put it into your story, so that we can get through it all. So just stay focused, please. Okay. So A's, I want you to think of a 90-second story about a time you wanted something and you got it. Okay, a time you wanted something and you got it. It does not have to be a fantastic story. Okay, it's something you can tell in 90 seconds. It could be, I really wanted that coffee at Starbucks. Go with the first thing that comes in your head. Don't kill yourself over this, okay? A time you wanted something and you got it. B's, I want you to think about a story, about a 90-second story about a time you wanted something and you didn't get it. Okay? So I'm going to give you about 30 seconds not to talk with each other, just to think of something.
Oh, we're not talking to each other.
Yeah, no, at this point you're not talking to each other. You're just coming up with it yourself, okay? Doesn't have to be a good story. I really wanted to punch my sister in the face. All right, everybody got something? Do all the A's at least have something?
Yes.
All right, fantastic. Okay, here's what we're gonna do. So A's face B. So B, put your story on the shelf for now. You are gonna coach A now. You're going to rehearse this four times, four different ways, and by the end you're going to have a fantastically polished 90-second solo show, and then we're going to reverse, and A's are going to coach B, and we're going to go through that process again, and then at the end you're all going to perform them for each other, okay? So, I'm going to time you, so I will say start and stop. So 90 seconds now. A, tell B your story, and B's, you're the coach, so you're listening for, I'm going to give you 90 seconds to give feedback about what could help make it a better story along the lines of what we're talking about. Is there a clear I want song? Are there obstacles? Do they get what they want in the end? Is it clear? Okay? So 90 seconds, go.
Okay. That story is like one of those. So what ends up happening is, it happens 2 years or so.
B's, you're going to give them some feedback, how to tighten it up, how to give it a clearer arc, more than I want, obstacles, and then how it ends, okay? And 90 seconds of feedback, go. Adjusting bra straps, okay. Tell your story again, employing the great notes that you just got from your expert coach, but also, because they can't see you, you're going to use your voice in as many evocative ways as you can. Maybe you do character voices, or you do sound effects. I open the door. Maybe you increase volume. Get really quiet to create tension. Maybe you do silence, right? So there's lots of different things. So bees, in addition to listening for notes to give them to help keep shaping the story, you're also listening for three great vocal things that they do that they can put back into their story. Okay? And 90 seconds, go.
Like,
Space here, so you guys can spread out. Okay, then you're gonna understand. Katie, you guys should move back, move down this way a little bit more. If you guys want to, okay. So this time, you're gonna face each other, and A's, you're gonna tell your story without using any words at all. Meaning, we're gonna now employ the long treasured theatrical tradition of mime. So you're gonna act it out as much as you can, and B's, you're not just passively watching it, oh no. You are mirroring everything they do, but exaggerating it to encourage them to go even further, okay? And while you're doing that, you're noting three great physical things that they do that they can put back into their story. And I'll give you an example of what this might look like. So if you were gonna tell the story of the part of the story where you have to go down using a flashlight into a scary basement and look behind the boiler, you act like you'll be A and I'll be B. Okay, so go ahead. All right, you guys got the picture? All right, great. Off you go, 90 seconds. And I promise you, you'll finish this one quickly, so take your time. Okay, and go. Okay, and time. 90 seconds of feedback. Three great physical things they can put back in their show. Go. Again, this time using all the great story notes you've gotten, the wonderful three vocal things that you're going to add in, the fantastic three physical things that you've just added in, and you're going to perform a 90-second perfectly imperfect solo show for your partner, and then your partner will get one last chance to give you notes and polish it. Okay? 90 seconds. You ready to go? And go. Shelf for, because you're going to be a coach now for a little while, but just get it in your body so you're going to be able to return to it. Okay? And now, you are going to coach B. So B, what was your 90-second story about a time you wanted something and you didn't get it?
Okay.
Okay? So A's, this time, the first time through, you're just going to tell the story, and A's, you're going to give feedback. Okay? And you're ready? Go.
I'm going to go to the next one.
feedback now. For those of you who say, how can I possibly get to the end of this, right? One way of making something shorter is replacing a huge chunk of explanation with a single physical gesture. Right? Sometimes that can really help. Okay? 90 seconds of feedback. Off you go. Voices, sound effects, volume, loud or slow, speeding up really fast, really slow to build tension. Anything you can do to help tell your story through your voice. And A's, not only are you listening to help them continue to shape the story, but also what are three great vocal things they can put back into their show? 90 seconds, go. I'm going to go to the next one. stop talking.
It is.
Sort of like ghosts. Okay, excellent. This is the fun one, facing each other. B's telling your story using just your body. A's not just watching, imitating them and exaggerating it even more. While in your head, you're also keeping track of at least three great physical things that they can put back into their story. Everybody ready? Take your time, because as you knew last time, you finish fast, right? So take your time and go. Okay, 90 seconds of feedback, great. Actually, before you talk, I just want to say one thing, you guys. These two over here were like, we're too shy to do this. I look over and they're like,
it's not crazy shy. Show.
Well, it was so awesome.
Feedback on motion.
Yeah, so feedback on three great physical things they can put back in the show.
Well, I physical things, creating this unbelievably amazing and completely wrong solo show. Okay. And then you get 90 seconds of feedback. Off you go, 90 seconds. Get ready, go.
Thank you.
So here's my proposal to you guys. This class is supposed to go until 4. It is now 3:30. We started late because of all this stuff. We don't have to be at the bus or whatever for the next thing until 6. So what I propose is that we go until 4:30. Okay? And that will allow everybody to perform and everybody to see everybody else perform. Otherwise, I'd have to divide it into 2 groups. And I think it'd be much more fun if we were all got to see each other. Yeah. Okay, are we okay with that?
Yeah.
I don't want to stop for a bathroom break because I want you guys to stay in the zone of this. So if you have to go, just go while we're going. Okay. On the floor in the back. Okay. So why don't we create a little this audience here looking at this, because I think there's some light here. So this will be the performance area. Yeah, let's have a seat. And again, if you want to sit in a chair, you can grab a chair. If you want to sit on the floor, I kind of like making it more like minute stories, okay? So aim for that 90 seconds, but don't feel like you gotta rush so fast that you can barely talk. Okay? So just go up when you feel like it. We'll have a discussion at the end. And we're just gonna go for it. And just remember that like anything worth doing is worth doing badly. Alright, so just get up. You know, I used to work with Anne Bogart and she always used to say like every time you do something you should both succeed wildly and totally fall on your face at some point. You know, because that means that you're risking, you're putting it out there. So I just applaud you all for doing this. I can't wait to see these stories. They're going to be great. And whenever anybody wants to get up, then go for it.
All right.
Okay. So back in high school, when I was a junior, I made friends with this cool gothic chick named Heather. She wore black all the time. And we found out that there was a free trip to Disneyland being offered. And we really wanted to go to Disneyland, bad. So we joined the Quiz Bowl team, me and my goth friend Heather. And there are these two nerdy guys on there too. They really, they were kind of inconsequential because we got this. We practiced, we put notes on mirrors. Let me tell you what Quiz Bowl is all about. It's all about marketing. It's all about marketing terms. You know, point of sale, what does marketing mean? So we memorized all that stuff, the whole glossary. We get to competition. We beat out everybody else in Oklahoma. We get there. Lo and behold, the night before, Heather has to pick a fight with me. She borrowed my Walkman, and I wanted it back. I needed my Walkman back, and she accused me of being selfish. Said, "You're so selfish. You're always so selfish. Why are you so selfish? I can't stand you." Like, it's my Walkman, Heather. Just want to listen to a song. So that kind of put a rift between us, which was really bad. It was the night before Quiz Bowl. So we get there, sitting there, questions are flying at us. She's answering every single question before I can even get a chance to put my hand on the buzzer. And I'm not completely convinced that she knows all the answers. So I'm looking at her, I hear a question, I know the answer, and I've got my hand over here, and she's got it. I'm like, Claire, stop it! Well, I won the Quiz Bowl for us. I got the last 2 questions. Bam, bam. Got it. We won our trip to Disneyland.
That's what I got over with.
Okay, guys, can you also just say your name when you get up there?
Oh, sorry, Hector Pino.
Sorry, guys.
You're all seated? Yeah. So I'm 10 years old,
years old, and this is the premiere of Pedro Almodóvar's Kika in Miami. It's sold out, and I really want to see this because this guy's like, I'm a film guy, okay? So this is like my freaking idol, besides Chaplin. Okay, great. So I go there with my cousin, Frank, and we're in the lobby. Somehow we snuck in because I snuck in, not because he snuck in. And, you know, the thing's sold out. How are we going to get in? There's like, you know, guards everywhere. And next thing you know, this limo just pops open, and here comes out, like, you know, his protagonist, transsexual actress, another thing, and Pedro Almodóvar, and his entourage, and all these bodyguards, and I'm like, shit, there's no chance. Frank, shut the fuck up and just follow me. So I go and I run into the entourage, and we go, like, all into the theater, and, you know, we sit down backstage, and I'm like, I lived in Spain, he's from Jersey, so I'm like, you shut the fuck up, because you don't even know, you don't even speak Spanish, okay? So I'm sitting there, like, all Spanish and shit, you know? And the bodyguards are going, like, these two guys, so I'm like, how am I gonna do this? And then I hear, like, you know, they're interviewing Pedro Almodóvar, and he's like, oh, it's the 40th birthday of, you know, the transsexual, you know, protagonist. So I'm like, great, Frank, shut up. Oh my God, you're 40? I can't believe this. You look amazing. Oh my God, when you're, and she's like, oh, really? You think so? You don't even look 30. And next thing you know, we're walking in hand into the theater. We sit front row, Pedro Almodóvar sat two rows behind me. Ryan. So in college, you eat pizza, you eat Doritos, you eat anything you get your grubby little paws on. And that is totally what I did with my college roommate, who I had a total crush on. And we would be sitting watching How I Met Your Mother, flipping through the channels, snacking on Doritos, and I'm thinking, I've got like a huge boner for you right now. So, but I don't want to get this with this guy. He's totally straight, it's not gonna happen, except one night he walks in, nothing but a tank top, boxes, drenched, drowning, and he just shows up at my door and he's like, hey. And he gives me an embrace, and it's like really like a lover should, but he's like totally like a bro would not do. And I'm like, okay. You just sit down, and he just wants me to give him a massage. So I'm like, oh, okay, I can do a massage, it's totally fine. So I just go in there, like deep shiatsu, really fucked up version of massage, and he stops me. And he just turns his face and you start making out. We're like pushing to the walls. Like he's like, it's a total porno flick. And we just like, we're going to bed. We're just like totally going at it. I mean, it's okay. But we're just still being like, that's funny. It's messy. And the next morning I'm like, hey, baby, was that okay? Is that fine? I mean, is this totally cool? And he's like, dude, we totally can't do this again. Like this never happened. You're like Doritos. I mean, we didn't really speak again until like a year later, but yeah.
All I wanted was a really nice hot shower. I'd been spending the weekend at my mom's because I thought she was dying of an aneurysm, but her water pressure sucks. So I just needed to get back to my loft apartment in New York City. I was gonna park the car out front, double park. I ran up trying to get my boyfriend out of bed. He was still in bed, it was like noon, and I was like, shit. So I go back down, I spend like 15 minutes parking the car. I'm so annoyed with him that he wasn't up, ready to park the car for me. Now I'm all hot, sweaty, I really need the shower. I get back to my apartment, and there he is. He's not up in the loft bed anymore. He's lying on the couch. He's muttering incoherently. I'm like, this is great, honey. This is really fucking great. My mom is dying, and you've like clearly been drinking till like 5 minutes ago. I'm like, what the fuck are you saying? You're waking. What are you saying?
I think I broke myself.
And then I look at him, and his body is like all contorted, and I realized he was chasing me to say he would park the car for me. But he'd fallen from the loft bed, and he'd broken his hip So I'm like, fuck, I really want to shower. I call 911 and I take him to the hospital. And I was like, do I get in the ambulance? I do. And I get him safely in the hospital. And then I ran home and I finally got that shower. And I felt so guilty.
Name?
Oh, Barra.
So I went to a launch party last week, and all I could think about is I'm 58 years old. I haven't had sex when I was 58 years old. All I could think of is I want to have sex! 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 I want to have sex! 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 I want to have sex! So I see this guy that I know. Pay any attention to me, and I went out to a bar afterwards with a friend of mine. I picked up the phone and I called him and I said, hey, I think you're really sexy. And he's like, who is this? No. And I said, I'm really sorry I ignored you because I just think you're really sexy. I hung up the phone. I left this message and doesn't call. Next day, walking around the corner from work, I get a call. And it's the sex guy. He said, oh, my phone was broken. I was all night at what's the name of it? I don't know. Where are phone people get their phones fixed? And he asked me out, and I said, you know, I can't go out. I got to do this thing for CityWrights. So I can't go out. So I said, why don't we come over after the show? And he said, okay. And I said, well, sex. So he came into my bedroom, took all his clothes off. Now, the last time I had sex, I had a stroke. 10 strokes. 10 times sex, 10 times strokes. So I'm looking at his body, like this, and we went for it. Went for it. Hey, marijuana, why you do this? Okay. I'm 58. How old are you? I have a neurologist appointment the next day, and I went in, and the neurologist is very shy, and he goes, Miss Swain, have you had sex? I said, well, yeah, but does bad sex count? He said, well, did you have a, I waited, because I'd like to have sex with him too. Did you have an orgasm? I said, no, but he kept doing this. What is this? So he said, well, that's good, but now we don't know the stroke. Sex when I'm 59 too. Oh, I'm done.
By the way, we're gonna take it down now.
My little surgeon said I could do that.
I forget. The biggest regret of my adult life was moving my brother close to me. I used to love going to see her. She was 5.5 hours away, and we would watch old movies and play rummy and go play bingo. Bingo! I loved yelling bingo with my mother. So my father passed away, and I had a brand new baby, and we thought it was a good time to move her 5 minutes away. And all of a sudden, it wasn't fun anymore. It was, can you? Not even candy. What am I saying? It was never a question. You must. I need. You will. Mom, what do you need? You need to pour this jug of milk half into this jug because one jug's too heavy, two jugs are lighter. Okay, great. Bye. What? The mail. I was just there 5 minutes ago, and of course I have nothing to do, Mother, but tend to you. I really grew to hate my mother. And on a Friday night, I was with my girlfriends having cocktails, and I said I truly believe I'd be better off if my mother would just die. But you know what? God doesn't take people like my mother. And then that following Monday morning at 8:30, she flatlined in the ER right in front of me. She never said, I love you. I used to say to her all the time, Mom, you never say I love you. She says, yes, I do. Every time I yell at you, that's my way of telling my mother. And she was flatlining. And I walked over to her and I said, Mom, I love you.
and the silence, of course.
I'm Guillermo. The boy was autistic, so he didn't speak. He was just sitting on the bed, throwing horses at the wall, one after another, after another. I walked in, sat there. I was hoping I would be able to tell his mom that I could help him. And then he just threw horses at the wall. I said, hi. He threw a horse in my face and continued throwing horses at the wall. So I was thinking, oh my God, I'm not going to be able to help this boy. And then something came to me. And I said, you're doing it wrong. Just look at me. And I said, for this game to work, two people have to do it and we have to take turns. So he gave me a horse. I said, throwing horse, he threw the horse. I threw the horse, he threw the horse. I said, you want to improve it? He nodded because he didn't speak. And I said, now we do the white horses, then the brown horses, and then the black horses. So we started taking turns with black horses, brown horses, white horses, small horses, big horses. And then I said to him, since he didn't speak, this was a big challenge. Do you want to do it a lot better, much better? He nodded. And I said, now what would you say? Hi, horse, throw it away and say, by horse, and he took the horse. Ah, horse, throw it by horse. And those were his first words.
My name is Anne. So I woke up in the desert that is El Paso, extremely hungover, and I had to be at a wedding in a few hours. So anyway, if I didn't get food in my stomach, I was going to be incredibly sick and embarrassing for my entire family. So the problem is I'm a vegetarian, and I was in Texas. So I needed to find vegetarian food in the desert in Texas while really hungover. So I got a really big floppy hat, I put it on, and I went outside. And I live in Florida, but I have never experienced sun like this. It was oppressive, it was awful. So I was like, this is fine, I can do this. So I started walking, and within 3 minutes, some guy in a pickup truck wearing a Stetson pulls up and is just like, hey, little lady, you need a ride somewhere? And I was just like, no! And kept walking, and immediately I was like, why? No, that was so stupid. I looked around. I realized there's actually no shade in Texas because nobody walks in Texas. Like the assumption is we don't need shade in Texas. So I keep going and I just think, okay, at this point I don't need a vegetarian restaurant. I just need any restaurant. I'm just powering through. Nothing's open. It's noon on a Saturday. Nothing's open. Pretty soon I can feel like the sweat is dripping down my face, it's dripping down my neck, I can feel it everywhere, and I look a hot mess. So at this point I just start running and I see other weddings, parties, every church I run past there's a wedding going on, it's just this reminder like I have to not vomit at my wedding, my cousin's wedding. So I just start running and I see this little diner in the distance and it looks sketchball. So I was just like, okay, I don't care, just coffee. I'm gonna lower my standards from vegetarian breakfast to just coffee. So I run into the diner, I sit down, and I say, hi, do you make anything vegetarian? And they say, yeah, we make fresh guacamole. I was just like, thank you. And I had fresh guacamole.
I love you, Spider-Man.
Hey. I'm Dara. My acting career was going nowhere. And it always had been some kind of growth. Even small growth, that's fine. 5 years, nothing. So I decided I had to ask for something. So I went to a friend who was directing at an off-Broadway house. I had not yet worked under an off-Broadway contract. And I just gotten my equity card, so that barrier was gone. I asked him to audition me. I figured there was one role in that show that would not be on offer. Small enough, I fit it. After 2 months, he tells me yes. That's only one role that we're not on offer with. Yes, I'm going to get you an audition. So I waited. I got an email from the casting director. I got the audition. It was on my birthday. I went to a friend's house the weekend before. She said, hey, this dress, you want this outfit? It doesn't fit me. It was perfect for the role. Perfect. Okay, I went to the audition. I felt that I did very, very well. He shook my hand and he said, you know, these things are so hard. That was the first clue. About 4 days later, I got an email from him. And I didn't get the part. But at least now I'm being rejected on a higher level.
China. There are three families. Two of us are parents, father, mother. One is a single parent, and we're waiting. There's a window, and I can see where they're going to drive up with the vans, with the kids. And I'm waiting at the window, and I'm waiting. And I see the first van come up, and the van door slides open, and it's a little boy who steps out, and I don't get a little boy. That's Pam's. That's hers. And then that van drives off, and quickly behind it, another van comes up, and a little girl steps out. It's not my little girl. You know, that's theirs. And the door slams, and it drives off. And I wait, and I don't see anything else, but the elevator is coming up with the other two children, and they come out with their caretakers. And Pam's little boy, Zach, sees her, and they see each other, and they just stand there, staring at each other. And they slowly walk to one another, and reach up their hands, and they take hands, and they never let go. And this family over here, they're kind of what I call the loud, noisy American family, and they take their daughter, and they've got a bag of stuff, and they're pulling out books, and they're doing all these things, and I said to my husband, God, it's like watching John Belushi in Animal House smashing beer bottles over his head to get everyone to laugh, and they're doing all this stuff, and I keep looking out the window, window as they're becoming a family. And I wait, and I wait, and I wait, and I wait, and the band never came. It wasn't until 2 o'clock in the morning that we finally came back.
The alarm clock had to be like that because the class was a 7 o'clock in the morning class. And it was really hard to teach at 7 o'clock in the morning, but I did it. It was a really shitty time, though, because my girlfriend was directing a show till like really late at night, so we never, ever, ever saw each other for like an entire term. And we were really looking forward to Christmas time because we were going to take the train down to Florida to see your family. And the auto train is this really cool thing. You drive to DC, you drive your car onto the train, and then the sun goes down, and you're in Washington, D.C., the sun comes up, and you're in Orlando, and then you drive like 2 hours to get to Miami. It's a really good thing. It's nice, and you're really excited about it, because we'd spent so little time together, and we had decided to splurge, and we got a berth room, which is a room that's like has a bed on the train. We both really love North by Northwest, and Cary Grant and Eva Marie Saint had that kissing scene on the train, and it's like so cool. So we were really excited about this time that we're going to have together, and it's going to be so romantic and wonderful. And the rooms are like the bed you pull down, and it goes boom like that, and it's like for a Smurf, it's for a little tiny. But it was very romantic, and I was struck by this incredible romanticism, and I proposed to her. And she said no. Because I didn't have a room.
Their names were Tyson, yes, like the fighter Mike Tyson, Tigre, which means tiger in English, and that dog's head was basically bigger than my head. Then the other dog's name was Princess. She had a pink nose and green eyes, and the fourth dog, which was the boxer, was named Bruno, after, I don't know, my brothers, I have two older brothers, decided to name them like that. Eventually, we moved out of that house, and all those dogs, well, some of them passed away, and some of them we gave away. And when we moved to this new house, all I really wanted was to have another dog again, because, I mean, I grew up with four dogs. But my mom, I'm from Honduras, a very Hispanic, strong woman, made it very clear that no tener perro porque they die. Hasta cansado, perro. You know, she's the kind of lady that emphasizes that she doesn't love dogs, but yet she really loves them, but from afar. So she made it clear that she didn't want me to have any dogs. I, of course, playing the, I'm the younger sister, I'm the small one, please get me my doggy. I emphasized it to my brothers, and they were like, I don't know, we're not sure. Mom made it very clear that she doesn't want any more dogs. But my birthday came around, and they surprised me with a baby schnauzer that I decided to call Pitufa. Which in Spanish, which in English means Smurf. Obviously, my brothers were like, that's a stupid name. The dog will eventually grow bigger and it's not gonna be a Smurf anymore. And I was like, but it's Pitufa, I mean, come on. So I got Pitufa and I just love my dog.
My first and only boyfriend broke up with me 5 years, and for the past 4 months I've been crying. I was like, oh god, like I really, like I was a hot doo-doo mess. I was just So then recently I found out that he had been cheating on me with a 40-year-old. So I was like, okay. So I was like, you know what? I've been crying over him no longer, no more. So I was like, okay, Cupid, here we go. So I'm like messaging people, and like I don't really find anyone interesting. So finally I meet this like really cute guy, and I'm like, oh man, are you real? Because you really seem cool and stuff, you know? And he's like, yeah, I'm pretty real. And I'm like, you want to Facebook each other and stuff? He's like, yeah, let's Facebook. And I'm like, okay. So then finally we're like, he's like, you want to meet? And I'm like, oh my god, yes, yes, yes. So finally we set the date, and I'm like, oh man, I'm telling my best friends, and I'm like, guys, this might be the one. Like, I've never met him. And then, so finally we set the date, but then, I don't know if you guys remember the storm that hit earlier, it flooded my house, and I was like, oh my god, I can't make it. Do you still want to meet? I'm free tomorrow. He's like, no, I can't. And I'm like, no. And then it was just awful. So then he set up another date, and I'm like, okay, good. So then I finally, we meet, and we're like, hi, whatever, and we spend a beautiful night together, we met, and it was wonderful, and then he never called me again.
Oh. I really like that she's wearing love on her leg.
I still believe in love.
Hi, I'm Christine. I feel like you should say, Hi, Christine. When I was a very young teacher, I snagged some tickets for a tour of Elephant Man that had come to Miami. Now, Miami at the time was not beautiful Miami, glamorous Miami. It was dirty, crappy, nasty Miami. It was scary Miami. And I had my new suit on because I was going to Gessman Hall, which is this beautiful theater. And I was really excited about it. And a pair of heels that I had trouble walking in. And as I walked from my car the few blocks to the theater, I felt my clutch purse come out from underneath my arm. And I said, what happened? And I turned, and I saw that it was a guy who had just stolen my purse. He was off the street corner. And I started to run after him because I knew the tickets to Elephant Man were in my purse. And so I ran and ran and ran. And I was as fast as I could, and I turned and saw all these people who were going to the theater had run after me. And so we created a mob. A guy gets to a parking lot, trips over the chain in the parking lot, drops my purse, tries to grab for my wallet, sees these people converging on him, and runs across the parking lot to a brand new Cadillac, gets in it, and drives away. But then I turned, and all these people who were going to the theater, we were so proud of ourselves. The theater had saved the day.
And then he cried out, I am not an animal.
I'm Linda, and I came out of the womb a writer. All my life, I dreamed how romantic it would be to be a writer. It's all I ever wanted to be, was a writer. But my generation had no qualms about putting a lot of responsibility on the firstborn child, which I also was. So I never had the opportunity to pursue my dream. I was raising my sister and brother, I got married, I now had a husband, he was a farmer, I'm digging trees, I'm planting seeds, I'm living his life, I'm doing everything for everybody else because that's what I was programmed to do. After my divorce, I came back to Miami and I moved in with some roommates who were all going to college and telling me how easy it was to go to college. Easy? Never. It's got to be the hardest thing in the world. Something that was unattainable for me. But I went down to Barry University and talked to a counselor who immediately cut me off at the knees. I hated that bitch. You can't do it. You can't get the financial aid you need. I cried. I cried in her office. I cried all the way home. And then I thought, you know what? I'm not going to let that bitch stop me. I went back down to Barry University. I talked to a counselor. He encouraged me. I marched myself right back into that bitch's office. And I sat down and I said, let's figure out a way for me to go to Barry University. Now, we are the best of friends, and I am an accomplished writer.
Hi, I'm Katie. So I went to see a life coach because I was just like, oh my God, number one, I don't know what I necessarily need to be doing, but I have got to make more money. And this is just ridiculous. And she was like, I was like, you know, what different things could I be doing for a day job, you know, blah, 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 make more money acting, blah, blah, blah. She was like, I don't know, but you need to ask for a raise right where you are. You need to be making $10,000 more. Ask for a $10,000 raise. I was like, that's hilarious. I work at a nonprofit social service agency. The profit increases zero for 3 years. 3,000 employees, like, they're gonna laugh at me. It's like, hey, you just said they love you. They're not gonna laugh at you. And I was like, you have to ask, it doesn't matter. I was like, I want to go somewhere else. No, before you go anywhere else, you're asking for $10,000. So I asked all my friends, how do you ask for a raise? I'd never really done it. I was terrified. It's not easy for me to ask for what I want. So I was like, I don't want to do it. I don't want to do it. I don't want to do it. I happen to be having my review. She gives me my review. I was like, now's the time. I went in her office. I was like, I closed the door. She's like, you're gonna quit. I said, no, I'm making this. I can't make that anymore. We want to have a family. I want to buy a house one day. I've got to take better care of myself. I need to be making $10,000 more. And she was like, Katie,
Of course you deserve $10,000 more. I had no idea you were making that little, and I'm gonna do everything I can to get it for you. And 6 weeks later, she went to her boss, she said no. She went to the big boss, the CEO of the company. He was like, we can't lose Katie, she can have $12,500.
My friend got engaged after 3 months, and I was convinced this is not going to happen for her, this is not going to work. But then I go, it's her wedding, I'm the bridesmaid, I'm walking down the aisle, and I go, and I'm walking down the aisle, and they're so in love. And I become convinced in that moment, yes, that's right. And not only that, oh my God, I want that so bad, I want that. So I go back to Iowa City, and I'm like, I've seen this guy, he's got great red hair, he's really cute. He's an app designer, he's really busy, I'm really busy. But this is gonna work, this is totally work. So I do my thing, I'm working, he's working, he's working. What's up? Hey, I'm taking classes, I'm working on my thesis and 2 productions simultaneously while Skyping outside with directors. And this is totally gonna work, it's totally gonna work. So the thesis deposit comes due, and I realize, oh crap, I put it on the wrong paper, so I've gotta go to Walmart, I'm going to Walmart. I'm like, okay, I don't need apple juice to my fridge is empty, and blah, 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 and this and that and that. And then I go and I'm like, okay, I got the drone, but this, I'm going to Minneapolis now. Okay, this can totally work because he's portable. He's an app designer. He's saying they're portable. This is so great. This is all working out. And then I go away for this month, a bunch of development stuff, come back for 5 days, and I'm able to see him. He's filling in completely. He comes over for a night. We sit down. He says, I don't think we should become romantically involved. I don't know. Okay, because I'm too busy. No, because you don't listen. And it's me this entire time. I haven't been listening to him. I've just been really busy and seeing him. And I realized, okay, my heart's a quarter way broken. Painful training wheels for the next relationship. And also I realized, man, he's a really bad communicator because I had no idea.
Katie and I have prepared a joint.
Katie prepares a lot of joints.
Hey-o. Okay, I'm Mona. My best friend, Danielle, is an actor. I live in Sarasota. She got a gig, a horror film in Orlando, which is 2.5 hours away from Sarasota. So I'm not involved in this horror film thing at all, but I just go with her to keep her company on the drive. And the whole way she's telling me how awesome this director is, and I'm like, sure he is. And then we get there, and I see him, and he is awesome. He's fucking, and he's, ah! And I felt really derpy and awkward, and I was like, why am I here? And then he and I kind of clicked and started laughing and started really getting along. He's like, hey, are you an actor? And I was like, yes. Then he asked me to do voiceover stuff. So I did, and it was so fun. We had so much fun. There was like a lot of screaming and laughing, and the screaming was the job. That's what we were supposed to be doing. The laughing was the fun part. And then he invited me back to do a photo shoot of like dead bodies and all this stuff. And it was just so fun. Like I was all bloody, but like trying to look cute for him. So it's like, like gushing out of my face. I'm like, we belong together. Then after that day that was just all of this fun, all of this much fun, he said, do you want to just be in the film? Because you've kind of weaseled your way in anyway. And I was like, you invited me. And he was like, you weaseled. And there was like a lot of that going on. Because that's how we joke. It was like, so us, you know? Then, yeah, so then I was in the film, and it was fun, and we had like a whole 24-hour shoot. It was a horror film, which you'd think would be scary, but it was actually really fun. And then the sad moment came where he's like, thanks, guys, this is the end of the shoot. So then Danielle also is equally as obsessed with him, like she thought he was awesome too. We're walking back to the car, and we're all sad, and then he sends us a text that was like, to Danielle about both of us. He said, I'd like to take you and Mona out to dinner, because I think you guys are a lot of fun. And we're like, ah! Yeah, sure, we'll totally do dinner, like, that'll be awesome. And then we said we would love to. He said, I'll let you know. Then a day passed, and I was like, and then a week passed, and then he never did let me know. So that's the story of me not getting what I wanted. But
I did save a little Chinese girl on the top of Mount Everest.
I'm using a chair. Dylan is my name. So I was at this party, and it was an okay party, and it was like the end of the year, and I was like, okay, I'm gonna go to this party, and I'm bouncing because I don't dance, and I'm holding a drink in my hand. And I like look to the left, and my ex has just walked through the door, and I'm like, okay, I'm gonna dance over here and hide. And then another ex walks through the door, and I'm like, okay, I'm gonna go to this corner. And at this point, like, what do you do when both of your exes are at a party? You get drunk, so I get drunk, and I'm sorry, no, don't tell my mom. And I finally, I like wasn't feeling well either, and I was like, I'm just gonna go to sleep. So I walk into this bedroom, and I like sit down to go to sleep, and I'm like curled up, and I kind of sleep like Jesus. So I'm like this, and I'm like trying to go to sleep, and then a couple burst through the door, and they're just like, they like fling themselves onto the bed on my arm, and I'm like trying to sleep, and I like woken up and like, oh my god, and of course I realize it's my ex in the couple, and I'm like, oh my god, and I'm half drunk, and I'm like, and I'm pulling, and I use this as leverage, and then my friend bursts through the door with her girlfriend, and she plops herself down on this arm, and I'm strapped to the bed at this point, and I'm like pulling myself up, I'm like having an exorcism, like in the cell, and I finally like free my arm, and I get up, and I didn't sleep for the rest of the night, and I just sat, and couldn't find a bed. That's the end of the story.
Christmas
breaks. Barbara Lowry. It was Barbara Lowry.
Hi, I'm Andy. So it's New Year's Eve, 2000. I am 16 years old. And it's, you know, it's the new millennia, so it's very exciting. Except I'm not allowed to go anywhere because my mom had a prophecy or vision when she was pregnant with me that I would die in a horrific death on New Year's Eve 2000 at like 16 years old. So being a far-thinking teenager, I'm like, I will invite all of my friends over and we'll celebrate the entire New Year. So we'll celebrate starting with the international dateline and just move our way forward, staying up for over 48 hours. Happy New Year's, international dateline. Happy New Year's, Sydney, Australia. Happy New Year's, Jerusalem. And we're staying up all night. And I had invited the first boy that I had with glasses that I had a crush on. And he was just, oh, it's exciting. And so there was a point in the evening after, you know, we rung in New Year's for the East Coast. And we were in my living room, and it's 4 o'clock in the morning, and for some reason all the other friends are elsewhere in my house. And it's like I'm alone with him for one moment. And I lean up to kiss his perfect lips, and he says, "Don't push your luck." And I've been up for 48 hours at this point, so I'm not quite processing this, and I just sort of slink off to the couch, and I sort of go like on the floor, and I realized that that was kind of when my first love died.
Now we get to the shy people.
Okay, wait, wait, wait.
Yes. Yes.
Okay, so my name is Mimi.
Really shy.
So,
what's your name?
Mimi.
Really shy.
So all I've ever wanted is for my mom to stop calling me. She calls me 50 times a day, and I'm not exaggerating. And in order to like let you guys really understand the extent that this is, I'm going to go through everything that I do or everything that happens to try to stop her from calling me. Hello? Hi, yeah. Mimi, where are you? I'm in the car, I'm going, where are you going? I don't know, I'm trying to figure it out on the GPS. Oh, okay. Okay, I have to go because I can't look at the GPS. Okay, bye. What? Where are you going? Well, I don't know, I'm just trying to figure it out with the GPS. Okay, bye. Mom, you're so disrespectful. You don't care about my life. You don't care. not doing anything. Yeah, I ate spaghetti. Yeah, okay. Oh, I'm dead. Knock, knock, knock. Hello?
Hi, are you Maria?
Yeah?
Hi, I'm coming from the Dallas police.
Are you okay?
Yeah?
Do you have an illness?
No.
Oh, okay, because your mom called. She's real worried about you. She should call your mom.
Oh, okay, thanks.
So if I don't answer the phone, my mom will call everybody. Everybody, including ex-boyfriends.
Oh, hello! Hi, Miss Davila.
Hi, do you know what Mimi is?
No, I haven't spoken to her for 3 years. So, I mean, no matter what I do, she will never stop calling. Ain't no mountain high.
Very masturbatory, didn't the rest of you?
I'm Mike. As a 40-year-old inexperienced driver, it was my first time on the interstate. And I'm driving carefully, and zoom, the cars go by me, and zoom, they go by me, and they honk at me. I get off at the first turnoff I can. I flunked the interstate. And I decided from then on I would only take side streets. A year later, my roommate asked me to pick him up at the airport. So I drove the hour and 15 minutes it took to get to the airport on the side street. I got there, he loaded his bags into the car, and I got back in, and I drove, and by accident, I was on the interstate. And I said, I gotta get off here. But the ramp off was all the way on the other side. So I stayed on the interstate, and we got home in 20 minutes. And from then on, I always took the interstate.
It's like Medea. Come in, you want to come in? You can just unlock the door. Come in and have a seat.
Hi, I'm Phyllis. Well, I had a friend who insisted I take a playwriting class. I really did not want to take the class, but he was a good friend, so I went to the class. And I enjoyed it, and my playwriting teacher said to me, you must take acting. I do not want to be an actress. I do not want to be an actress. He said, it will help you with your playwriting, dear. So I said, okay. And I went and I took acting lessons. 3 weeks later, he said, did you take the acting lessons? I said, yes. Well, they're having an audition, and you must go to the audition. I do not want to act. Well, I got ready to go to the audition, and I was very nervous. I was terribly nervous. I didn't want to be there, first of all. And I kept saying, what am I doing? So, in order to get noticed, I took my stuffed teddy bear with me. The director's going to remember me. And I walked in with the teddy bear, and he looked me up and down, and he kind of shook his head. But I went through the audition, and I figured, well, he's got to remember me. And the playwriting teacher's putting on the pressure. Did you get a call? Did you get a call? And he said, I did not get a call. I do not want to be an actress. And I never did get the call. But it didn't matter, because I got the experience and I knew it was nothing to be afraid of. The director was a man. an add-on addition. I did not take the teddy bear, but I got the jar.
My name's Tatiana Marie. So I got a call to go on this audition and I was so excited and they told me you need to be there in 20 minutes and you have to wear pajamas. And I was like, all right, fine. So I'm driving from Little Havana to South Beach and I'm rushing because I have to be there in 15 minutes. So I get to the front desk, I'm inside the building and I'm like, hi, I'm here for the audition. And the girl's like, you're here for the audition? Yeah, I'm here for the audition. She's like, do you know it's a McDonald's audition? And I was like, it's a McDonald's audition? Yeah, I knew it was a McDonald's audition. So then I go upstairs and I'm like, it's a McDonald's audition. So then I go inside and we had to wake up in the morning and really be craving chicken. I don't know who craves chicken in the morning, but I don't crave chicken. So I go into the audition room and I'm like, quiero el pollito, pero por favor, por favor, dame el pollito. So I leave there and I'm pissed off because I don't know why they sent me to a McDonald's audition. So then I got home and I was pissed off that they sent me to the McDonald's audition. So the next day I get a call and I was like, hello? And she's like, hola, Tatiana. And I'm like, yeah. She's like, mira, no te voy. Oh, well, let me say it in English for all you. She's like, we cannot give you the job of McDonald's, but let me tell you something. I have a little bit on a telenovela, if you can come in and do it for me. So, I didn't get the McDonald's job, but I got a job!
I'll also use a chair. Hi, my name is Mark. As a kid, I was really obsessed with roller coasters, and there's this website called RCDB. It's like IMDb, but for roller coasters. It's really awesome. And when I was a kid, I wanted to go into engineering before I found theater. I wanted to design roller coasters, even though I was definitely afraid of them. Like, I didn't want to ride them. I just wanted to, like, patent all these cool designs that my friends could do. I don't know. And then I started, one time, I psyched myself up. I was at Hershey Park, and I did the Super Duper Looper, which was the roller coaster with the first loop in the world. And then I went on, and I was like, okay, maybe I could do this. And then I did Shikra at Busch Gardens, which was 200 feet, and I'm like, that's it, no more. And then I had a couple roller coasters on my bucket list, and there's a theme park in Jackson, New Jersey, called Six Flags Great Adventure, and it has this roller coaster called Nitro, and it's 230 feet, and I was fucking terrified. When I look, like, you start at the ground, and then, like, you hear the Terminator music as you're looking up, and it's like, dun-dun-dun-dun-dun. You know, I'm like, I can't do it. I was with my cousin, and we were just like, let's just get on the line, okay? That's one step. So I got on the line, and I'm, you know, fucking freaking out. It was actually, I actually have a solo one-person show that I did. It was more anxiety than preview of that. It was really bad. I was like, I'm having a heart attack. She's like, you're fine. So then we were waiting in line for the front row because that's what you do because I can't sit in the back, I'll fucking flip out. So I sit in the front so I could see everything coming. And then the front row says four people. So two people got on and we were like maybe eight people back. And they were like, oh, are there any twos? And we were like, where? I'm a two. So then I'm just like, my cousin don't think. I sat, I just said, start the ride, do it. So then we take off, and my cousin's like, oh my god, I can't believe you're doing it. I said, shut up, I can't believe I'm doing it either. And we go up the chain lift, and on a steel roller coaster, it's like fucking 2 minutes, and it's awful. And we got to the top, and like halfway down the drop, I was like, I own this bitch.
And I was waiting to hear back from some potential roommates that I had interviewed, and I know how to read people. So the guy that I thought was going to be the best roommate, he was really good looking, and like we hit it off right away. But of course, he was flirting with me in this way that like gay men flirt with women, and I was like, oh, this is going to be great because he's arty, he's like the CEO of some. He's like some hotshot CEO guy. He makes great conversation, and he's gay, so there'll never be a sexual tension. Perfect. And some of the other candidates, like this tall computer programmer dude with glasses and spoke in a monotone. I'm like, I don't want to be the mother of a 20-year-old guy. And then this like power lady lawyer who scared me a little. He was like, I was waiting to hear back from him. I was really kind of hoping he'd be the one who said yes. And so he writes me an email the next day, and he's like, I decided not to take this room because you're kind of charging a lot. And he like went on and on. You're kind of charging a lot, and I think I'm gonna find another place on my own probably. Blah, and I'm like, this is much more information than I needed. You could just write this in one sentence. But then at the end he said, by the way, I really liked our conversation. I thought you were a fascinating person, and I was wondering if you would have a drink with me sometime. I was like, all right. So I wrote him back, hey, let's have a drink. And then we dated. So that's how much I can read.
Hi, my name is Idong. I'm a coffee addict. So it's about 8 a.m. in the morning, and I have to be at my job by 8:30-ish, so I have 30 minutes to spare. I'm cool. You know, I stop by my Cuban cafetera place, you know, mm-hmm. I get my little cafecito, I'm good, I need my coffee, my caffeine, I need it. I'm half asleep. So I'm here, I put it in my car, I sit in my car, and I see, oh, I need gas. I drive to the gas station. I'm okay, I still have time, 15 minutes to spare. I go up, grab the gas pump, and I everywhere, spread gas all over my car. No crap! I'm like, okay, it's okay. I put the gas, I put it back, and I see, oh, a car wash station. I'm good. I go to the car wash station. I'm chilling, I grab my little cafecito, I still have 10 minutes, I'm okay. The car wash tells me to drive my car forward, so what I do, I drive the car forward. I hit a bump. Coffee everywhere. I'm telling you, I'm all hot. I have a wedding to sing at. I'm freaking out. There's a puddle in my car. All right. I drive the car out of the car wash. I go to the lady in the gas station. Listen, I need some napkins. Can I please take these napkins? You're gonna have to pay for those. Bitch, the fucking napkins. I'm cleaning myself. Oh, shit. I literally have 7 minutes. Okay, I'm good. The car's clean, throw away everything, I get in the car, grab my the coffee that was left, okay? I'm like, okay, I'm gonna be able to drink this, I'm fine, I'm driving. I drop the coffee again. I go back to the lady, I'm 5 minutes, I say, listen, I'm taking these napkins and I'm not paying. I end up getting to the wedding, okay? On time. I look like a mess, but no caffeine, all right? Not one.
The title of that piece is How I Gave Up Coffee.
Yes! Yeah.
Glenn.
Who's left?
Glenn.
Oh.
Glenn, yeah. He left.
Okay. Yeah, I guess I'm a little nervous. I'm nervous now even thinking about it. You know, when you meet a writer that you really admire, that you really esteem. It was a few years ago, back in 2009, and I had just read his book, A Heartbreaking Work of Staggering Genius. Dave Eckers. I found myself in San Francisco, and I found myself in his community writing center. And I walked inside, and the writing center is like a pirate supply store. You walk in, there are peg legs, there are parrots, they're all the things that a pirate would need. And then behind the pirate supply store is the place where the writing takes place. So all these writers sit around these tables, and then comes in Dave Eckers, and I didn't want him to be an asshole. I really didn't. Isn't it terrible when there's a writer that you really like, and then he ends up being an asshole? But he wasn't an asshole, thankfully. But I was sitting there, and I was trying to think of a question to ask him, because I had read his book, which was about when his parents died, just after a few months after each other, which had happened to me the year before. And so it was a book that I really connected to, and I was trying to think of a question that wouldn't sound cheesy, that wouldn't be too emotional, that wouldn't make me start crying or anything like that. And so I finally, I raised my hand and I asked him this question. I don't even remember what I asked. But all I remember is his answer. Three words of advice to me. Just be weird. So, that's what I've been doing.
And I was returning two DVDs, three CDs to listen to, and some review books that I kind of opened the front cover and gave back because it's in the drawer. So I come up to the desk, $48.50 in fines. I mean, I understand it was a week and a half or so, but that is actually insane. Obama, fix this. This is public library. So, as a 17-year-old, I'm like, okay, I'll pay next time I come. I'm sorry, I just take these and I'm walking around the library, just browsing, and it's J.D. Salinger, and of the writers that have actually finished reading books, I love literature, but you know, you get busy, you don't have time for things. I read The Catcher in the Rye, 27 out of like 100 and something pages that fraction would be. I love the book, so I pick it up and it's Franny and Zoe. And I start reading it and I'm like, wow, I love the way that he writes. I love J.D. Salinger. And I'm in the back of the library and I'm like, I'm gonna be such a virtuous person and put this back and come back tomorrow and read it again. But they were closing in 10 minutes. And all of my angst for the Broward County Public Library system had been building. So I took the book and I said, you know what, I can do the right thing. Or I can do the right thing by learning in an alternative method. So I took the book and I put it in my bag and I respectfully walked out and took a free book from a public library.
We're having so much fun and I don't want to interrupt. Making sure you're checking time.
You only have one more and then we're...
Oh,
yeah. And then,
6 o'clock in the lobby. That event is free and open to everyone tonight, so if you have parents, friends, anybody that wants to come, there's a cash bar and food, and you may ride the bus with us or you can drive up there. The directions they have up front, but they're also on your schedule.
What's the time for tonight? What time will it wrap up?
Like 6:30, we'll start, and I don't know, until 9, and there's a band and stuff over there afterwards. It's like a big club.
But the bus comes back around?
Yeah, well, I think about 9:30, we should be back.
Okay.
So whatever you want to do.
Thank you, ma'am.
Have fun.
Thank you, ma'am.
This is all wonderful. Thank you.
Okay, who will go next? Where has it gone?
Gloria.
A couple people. Oh, okay.
Okay. Well, it all began when I was about 11 years old. I was playing the piano and played very, very well. And I walk into my teacher's class in her house, and suddenly she and her husband are having a liaison and walk out and don't know one another. And I was so embarrassed. I was just, I didn't know what to do. So she quickly runs out to me and she says, "Well, don't be so coy, these things happen." I ran home, I was really an innocent. I ran home and said, "Mom, I don't want to have this teacher anymore, I want another teacher." So she says, "No, you're not having piano anymore, no more. Why should you play the piano when your sister doesn't?" And my sister was always very jealous and she insisted on it. She says, "No, no, no," and I was crying. I was so upset. It was really, really a tough time for me. She said, "Well, you're going into high school. You don't need it. You won't have time for it." I was in high school, always listening to music. and I wanted to play the piano in the house, and my sister said, nope, that's my piano, you can't have it. Because it was bought for her, which she never played, but I was the one who played, and everybody stopped me. Well, it was really, really, really tough. I went to high school, I went to college, I got married, I had children, and all the time I wanted to play the piano. Finally, I got a piano at home. Then my husband got sick, and he died. And so finally, I started to take, not take lessons, but to play and write music. It's always in my mind to write music. And I write music now, and I've been writing music, and I've been writing songs, and I've been writing plays, and finally, Gloria has come to be Gloria. That's all.
It's our first morning in Miami. We've never been here before, but we're excited to be at this conference. But we're morning people. We have kind of a boring routine because we're boring. And we get up early and we have breakfast really early. And we write and then we do other stuff. And then we go have the rest of the suck day. And there's breakfast at the hotel, but I have to sell my car to eat there. So I look up on the phone and, wow, there's New York bagels. That's perfect. New York is made of bagels. It's like we'll be eating New York. So there is great. So we find our way outside, we go down through the downtown Miami, which before like 8 or 9 o'clock is apparently like an abandoned western town. There's metal shutters, there's people speaking into dumpsters. And the restaurant is about 2/10 of a mile away, says my phone, which knows everything. And that's like we're almost there. So, but before we get there, we see this other restaurant, which is also open for breakfast, which is amazing. And it looks like they have breakfast, and my wife wants to stop and eat there because she's hungry and it's early and it's too early to walk to breakfast. But I say, no, New York bagels, it's on the phone, it has to be good. This is just a random restaurant, how could that be good? So we continue on and we turn around the corner and there it is, a lovely golden sign across the street, New York bagels. It's gonna be great, eggs and sausage and cheese and big round breakfast. So we walk up and there's a guy outside sweeping the sidewalk. It's open, it's gonna be lovely and glorious. And we step inside and he turns around and said, no, John and Estella didn't show up yet. I'm gonna give them hell when they get here, but I can't serve you and say, I don't know anything about the line, you know? And so we go back to the other place.
It didn't work out.
Yeah, it just, you know, it didn't work out, man. She just kind of like, you know, she turned out to be a little dismissive. And, yeah. And I don't know what I've done. I don't know if she just like doesn't like my glasses, doesn't like the way I talk, the way I wear. She doesn't know my writing, so she can't be my play. You know? And that's it.
Everybody gone?
They were
okay.
All so good.
Yes, fantastic. Give yourself a round of applause. I know we want to wrap this up, but I just want to have a little bit of a conversation with you guys about it. First of all, that was a great example of persona, right? Mm. What's the persona?
From the minute I got up and didn't
nervous. Yeah, right? It's incredibly socially awkward, right? And what is this piece about? Right. So it's like, right, so when those things come together, it can be part of the performance, which it was, I think somewhat unintentionally, but that can be, you know, it's like, you know, it's doing a soul show is about capturing yourself, not about aspiring to something over here. You know, it's using what's actually there. It's just like when you've had a drink at a party and you're just having a good time and you're telling stories to your friends and you know, you really just, you know me, when I'm like, you know, and you're just like in that zone, that's doing a soul show. Okay? But I just want to hear from you guys. What was that experience like? What did you like? What did you learn? What did you hate? Whatever.
Scary.
Scary, yeah. What was scary about it?
I can't believe how vulnerable you have to be to get up there.
Right. And let me thank you for sharing that. And it was scary, right, guys?
Yeah.
When you watched other people and they revealed something deeply personal, what was your response to that?
They liked them more.
Yeah, right?
Yeah.
You want it, right? And it was the act, but the sense that there was, now you guys did a fantastic job of this. Every story had a direction, right? Had a point to it. So we didn't get caught up in, and then my mother died, right? We kept going, but there was wonderful moments of real feeling and humanity. And even if it's like a silly story, if there's this dimension to it, you know, like the story about meeting Dave Eggers, and and how like just saying like his father, you know, my mother or father died, or and mine had just died, like doesn't that suddenly like settle you in a much deeper way into the story? Like it brings this beautiful stake. So it is, like I was saying, it's this paradox. We want to hear something personal and dangerous from you. And this structure that I'm talking about lets you do it in a way that also does. Did you guys ever feel uncomfortable? Did you ever feel watching this like this was inappropriate? Let me ask you another question. How many people feel like everybody else's story was good, but theirs sucked? Yeah, right, okay, yeah, that's inevitable. Did anybody think anybody's story sucked?
No, they were all funny. I was surprised how funny they were. They were all funny.
So again, this is just our minds, you know? We like convince ourselves that we're not interesting, but you are all really interesting. You all have fantastic stories. Other thoughts?
Well, the people who did succeed, you were happy for them, and the people who didn't, you were engaged and you cared about them and you wanted them to.
Yep.
So both sides were engaging.
Right.
It was interesting to see the A's versus the B's. I think it was pretty clear.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah.
Who was an A and who was a B.
But it's nice, Mike's mixing it up because you don't know what's going to happen, right?
Yeah. The things that I thought was really interesting is the moments of collective gasp in the room.
Yeah.
We were all into A.
And why does that happen? Because you've hooked us with an I want song. Right?
Or a reversal of some sort.
But it's because we know what you want, so we know what's at stake. So when something bad happens, that's why we gasp. Right? I actually want to just go through and talk about a few of these pieces. If that's all right, unless people want to run out.
No.
Okay. Jesus, there was a lot. Karen? Was the first one, Karen? I love the...
Oh, Kendra.
I love the bam bam. I mean, the physicality of the bam bam. You know, like that was awesome. Hector, I love the way Hector. Works. It's one hand. Yeah, the way you created a character by saying his name, but also doing him on the thing. Frank, right? Every time. Frank, which is like when you're, if you're, and this is everything about creating work the way we did it is, if you're sitting there and typing, what are you going to say? My friend Frank, who's about 6'5" and always kind of obnoxious, but when you're doing a performance like this, you can just do it with Frank, right? We know who he is. Shut up, Frank, right? Awesome. Ryan. Yeah, great. The whole thing, okay. Sitting next to his roommate, eating Doritos, having this huge boner for him, right? That image, is that a great I want song? Right? Do we want him to get that guy? Absolutely, yeah. And he didn't. But you know, like you being like Doritos is nice because it's just like, I don't know, there's this, I feel like we get something from that, you know? It's like, but we learn like what a dick he is. Okay. Nina, one of the things that I loved about Nina's was the way you combined the mundane and the deadly seer and the really deep, right? It's of that thing of like, I really want to shower, you know, and my mother's dying, and like you've broken your fucking hip, but I want that shower. And that moment, we were all really engaged of like, 911, shower. 911, shower, you know? That was great. And I think that's a great thing in solo, sort of combined. You know, you say, I'm not interesting. A small thing, a small event can be fascinating when we bring into it what it means to us. You don't have to have climbed Mount Kilimanjaro. It can just be about the time you really wanted to shower. Bara? Yeah. I mean, the whole thing of like, I just love the whole, the callback of like, I want sex, the thing, and then achieving it. I want sex, like seeing it again. Fantastic. And also the idea, the danger of like the last time I had sex, I had a stroke, right? It was a funny story, and then all of a sudden it went to a really deep level, right? You're like, oh my God. Cricket, you know, you did a really interesting thing, which was, you know, sometimes the I want is actually a problem you have to solve, right? And so yours began with my biggest regret, you know? And one of the things I also loved was, I loved yelling bingo with my mother, you know? Mm-hmm. Like, in that one phrase, bingo, I love yelling bingo with my mother. We're in love with them as a couple, right? Mm-hmm. That's it, you got us.
Yeah.
And that's such a painful ending, you know? Such a beautiful. Guillermo. First of all, Guillermo, yeah, I loved how he started right in action, right? Mm-hmm. It was the boy was autistic and couldn't speak, throwing horses at the wall. I mean, you're just like, the fuck is happening, right? Then we're like, you really, you know, so starting right in the middle of the action. Mm-hmm. You know, a lot of movies start this way, right? They're like, it's like right before the climax, and then they stop right when like the horrible thing is gonna happen, and they say 6 months earlier, and then they like take us through the story. So that's a great technique for a solo show, is starting right in the heat of action.
I love movies like that too.
Yes. Like, right, and he had a very, you know, again, we love active protagonists, and he had a really great goal. Like, what are the times in your life you had a project, you really wanted something, what did he want? To help that kid talk, right? And how did he dealt with it with great ingenuity and creativity. And so we loved you for that, right? And then so that when you got what you wanted, which was that kid saying hi, horse, I mean, it was just like, right, heartbreaking. So beautiful, thank you. Anne, yes. I want to talk about just persona for a second. Oh, first of all, great setup at the beginning. I'm in the desert in El Paso, hungover, I got a wedding in hours, I'm going to embarrass my family, and I'm a vegetarian in Texas. Right? And that's a great persona, that's a great conflict, vegetarian in Texas. Like, we've got it, we know who you are, we know what's going to, you know, like, we know what's going to be a problem in this show. Terrific. Dara, you did a fantastic job of not getting what you wanted, but getting what you needed. Right? And that was, and I could tell that was difficult for some people because it was sort of like, and I didn't get it. And that's where the story ends, right? So that it is that challenge of like, well, what did I get if I didn't get what I wanted? And we always get something, even if it's just wisdom. And I, you know, and Dara had this great thing, which was I didn't get the part, but I was rejected on a higher level, right? And what she's saying there is like, you know, sometimes it's taking that bold action is the gift, you know, like outdoing yourself. So that was awesome. Holly, you know, that piece was so devastating. I thought you used a fantastic use of rhythm, which is something that you can do in solo show, which you can actually do in playwriting, but we don't think to do it, again, because we're sitting there and writing versus like feeling it with our bodies. You know, that just waiting, and this one goes, and that one goes, and waiting. and this car comes, and this car comes. Just that wonderful sense of, I mean, it just built and built and built. And although you didn't, because of the time, you didn't really give us the meeting. I mean, if you had even given us that meeting, it just would have, our hearts would have just like exploded in our chests. So beautiful, beautiful use of rhythm there. Brad. Wonderful I Want song, okay? I think, am I getting too much? Is it okay if I go through and give everybody like one little
note? Yeah,
okay. If you gotta go, you gotta go. A great I Want song can be a vision we have of something that we get from the movies, right? Like, for me, I wanted to be an actor. I grew up, I watched Tootsie, and I'd be like, that's the life I want. You know, Dustin Hoffman's life in Tootsie, you know? And then, like, you know, 20 years later, I'm in New York, like, out of work, working some horrible job in a horrible apartment. I'm like, I'm living that dream. But, you know, what was his? It was like being on a train, North by Northwest, Cary Grant, that other woman, the kissing scene, it was so cool. So we knew what the goal was, right? We knew this image of what he now had to fulfill, and of course it fell short, you know? So this is often the structure of a solo show. Another way of thinking of it is how I thought life was gonna be and how life was. And where do we usually get our ideas of where life, how life is gonna be, right? From movies, books, right? That image we carry in our brain that's like hardwired, that first time we fall in love, I think we fall in love first with somebody on the screen, right? Or something, and then we like we'll spend our life looking for that person. awesome, Esther, where's Esther? Right, great, wonderful, wonderful character of your mom, right?
Yeah.
Fantastic, that you know, and I mean, really, like you know, just awesome. So whatever you wind up doing with solo show stuff, character. But you can, you know, you don't have to do character monologues to have a lot of character in your pieces. And you had these like wonderful scenes between yourself and her, you know, you really just, I mean, it was so fun and funny. And also you were like, I'm the younger sister, you know, boom, persona. You know, that's who I am. Again, harder, it's often easier for us to be like, my mom is this crazy character. I don't know who I am, right? So it's just defining ourselves. Sometimes it's just I'm the younger sister. Laura. Yes, this is a great example of beginning with a story of trauma, right? First and last, first and only boyfriend, 5 years together, he breaks up with her, she's devastated, right? Now you could do a show about how horrible that is, but that hooked us because, oh my God, we're really feeling for you. And then you find out he's cheating and you say, so okay, Cupid, here we go. And you felt the audience was just like, yeah! Right? And that's because you went from trauma to action, right? And that's when we get on board with it. So it's like, whatever trauma thing that you, and it's great to write about trauma, it's great to write about a death or something like that, but look for what did I do in that situation? What did I go for? You know, one of my first solo pieces that I did, I actually had an eating disorder growing up. I know, it's actually the title of it was The Truly Macho Tale of My Manly Eating Disorder. And I had the lowest, I had anorectic and bulimic, I had 34, my heart rate was the lowest ever recorded in Connecticut, 34 beats per minute, I almost died. But I overcame it by therapy, but also by learning to break dance. And that was my way of like breaking into my very white school that I lived in Connecticut. So the piece is, it's about that eating disorder, but what it's really about is how breakdancing got me out of it. You know, so like, what is your path through? That's the thing that's gonna help make it something that's enjoyable for you to do and for them. And that's the other thing, is that like, it might be cathartic to tell that story once and just be in the pain of it, but if you have to do that 8 shows a week, you're gonna fucking kill yourself, right? So do make every solo show, no matter how sad it is, needs to be fun in some way for you to do. And doing something like Okay Cupid makes it fun for you, right? Okay. Christine?
Yes.
Christine? Wonderful. That's a great example. Where's Christine? Oh, there she is. You know, I love, that's a great example of your taking action makes an entire crowd take action, you know? And it was like, wasn't that thrilling to hear like her doing it? And not just like that she did it, but that there was this incredible universe like support of it. So it was just so fun, and it's such a great sense of need around those Elephant Man tickets. You know, I really got like how important those were. Katie, my wife. I don't know, Katie was terrible. I didn't really like her. You know, this is what I one of the many things I love about it. Is your body. you know, what is her want is to get this raise, right? And her the obstacle is what? her own doubt, right? Yeah. And she says, it's not easy for me to ask for what I want. And that's her persona, right? And you saw that persona from the beginning when they said, you're gonna give $10,000. Right? So we know this is a person who can't ask for what she wants. It's great when the persona is actually the obstacle to what you want. Yeah. So when you're trying to figure out which aspect of myself am I gonna accentuate in this piece, pick the one that's really about what your piece is about. You know, if her person, you know, because sometimes I know Katie, she's very brave. If it was like, they told me to get a raise, and I'm somebody who's easily asked for things I want. So what is the persona that will give you the most juice, you know, the most
confidence? I almost took it like she didn't want the job anymore and was hoping she wouldn't get the raise, and that would be an excuse to go.
Right, well, that's, I know that is part of the story for her. Oh. Okay. Deborah. wonderful, wonderful. You know, there was a great, your I Want song was really neat and complex because it was like the, you know, I had this friend, they got married really fast, I don't believe in that, right? So we see that she's kind of like a jade. She does she believe in love? No.
She wants to.
Well, then she sees that it works out and she transforms into,
I want some
love, right? But she's still kind of that jaded person who's leaving love. Because she gets in love, but she just tries to make it happen. She doesn't really care whether he's on that ride at all. You know? So a wonderful sense of like an I want song. Sort of, and what if she doesn't get what she wants, but what does she get?
I love a good lesson.
Yeah, she gets some insight into who she is, right? And it's scary. It's scary to, and embarrassing, right? You're blushing and you feel, right? It's embarrassing to be like, I don't listen. But it's great, you know, like, what's his name? Jack Benny made a lot of freaking money off of being cheap, you know? So a persona being something that isn't attractive about yourself can be awesome. So don't, every persona isn't like, I'm nice. okay, Mona.
I'm nice.
Oh, okay, yeah, you are nice. Great, also great persona, right? With the like, the this and the, you know, and then the like, and then when she got to like, we did this, and that was so us. Right? And she's like, known the guy for 12 minutes. So what is that persona? What is that persona?
Naive, infatuated girl.
Yeah, stalker, right? Exactly happen this way, it's okay to lie. And sometimes the lie is more emotionally true than what actually happened. If you're writing a memoir, somehow, like, you know, doing a theater show is different than writing a memoir. You know, like, if you lie in a memoir, you get in trouble. If you do a solo show, we know you're dramatizing it, so you can make shit up. Unless you're talking about somebody famous and you're attributing something to them that they didn't say, you know. Dylan?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, he was the worst thing. Anyway. Andy. Oh yes, wonderful. This was another example of, what did she want? She wanted to have this boy with the glasses, right? And she didn't get it, but a wonderful, what did she get? What?
She didn't die
out of years. Right, but there was this wonderful understanding of the prophecy. You know, the prophecy came true, but in a surprising way. And that was very satisfying, wasn't it? You know, and that was very surprising, wonderful, really poetic. You know, to see ourselves, you know, one of the ways I talk about this is to turn, we all have stories that we carry around with us, right, of the trauma that we've been through. And a lot of times we're ashamed of those stories. And part of doing a solo show like this is it's a very spiritual experience. And you really transition. By doing this, you start owning your story in a different way. And you transition from sort of thinking about your story as a tale of tragedy or woe, and you turn it into a myth of triumph. Okay? And it really changes how you go into the world after that. You know, great things happen from doing a solo show, like some of the things I talked about, because people see it, they option it or whatever. But something else happens, which is you start being in the world differently. Like that Michelle I was talking about, who, you know, was she was always kind of, her real, you know, the one who did the Asian Belle story about growing up Asian in the South. In a way, she would, her resistance to doing that show was the issue of the show, which was she was in a way still trying to pass, still trying not to foreground the fact that she was Asian. And once she did that show, she wound up becoming kind of a spokesperson for that. She started doing films and all these other amazing things. And there's a lot of times, that's why it's the thing we're scared of. The thing that we keep apart is often the thing to do the show about. And it, and it really, it transforms you. Mimi?
Here.
Yes, wonderful, so hilarious. Great acting out, right? Very little narrative. She just set it up and then acted out the scenes. Really, really fun. The more you can act out scenes and characters and monologues, the better, I think, with this kind of stuff. And then also, what did she get? What did she want? Her mom stopped calling her. What did she get?
The police officer.
Yeah. She got acceptance, right? Because she's, I realize at the end, she's never gonna stop calling me, right? So she makes her peace in some way with this thing. That's, you know, that's a great tragedy. Yes. Okay, fantastic persona, 40-year-old inexperienced driver. And then put him in the worst possible place for him. The interstate, right? So it's just like amazing conflict from the beginning, wonderful story journey, and then you conquer in your fear at the end, which is fantastic. Phyllis. She's still here. Did she? Did I get the name wrong?
Phyllis.
Okay, great. This was, great in so many ways. First of all, the persona is, I just don't want to be an actress, right? Like, that her I Want song is actually everybody else in her life. Like, they're all saying, you're going to be an actress, you're going to be an actress. No, I'm not. So she wants not to be an actress, and she doesn't get what she wants. She gets to be an actress.
Every time she did that, don't
want
to be an actress, she said,
I love that with a hand.
Yeah.
I love the actress. Great
job. Totally dramatic. Tatiana Marie. There you are. What an incredible personality, right?
Yes.
You just got, like, personality for days. But I really think, you know, I mean, there were so many great things about that piece. But I just want to say, like, I know you're going to continue to develop a larger show. This idea of being, because I hear you saying, like, except, you know, like doing something about being you, you know? And I think this could be the first story of your show, you know? That I get called in for a McDonald's thing, and the way she's like, you get called in for McDonald's? Like, what's going on there, which is how you're seen versus how you are, and, like, you know, I think is just a really meaty thing for you to continue to explore, right, guys?
Yeah.
This is very powerful. And you're gonna be a real role model, and, you know, it's gonna be a very powerful gift. Mark? Yeah. Mark, this is one of those examples of, like, the IMDb for roller coasters. I mean, how could you ever come up with this, right? It's so interesting, and it's like, this is where, like, real life, it's like, of course, you know, like, this is why this work is so fascinating, because it's just like, I mean, that we are weird. We are weird people, and we like weird things. And we just got so, didn't we get so on board for this, like, journey of, like, riding every great roller coaster, you know? And again, the great thing of, like, the guy who loves roller coasters but is terrified. You know, I don't know if I pronounced that correctly.
You don't.
Oh, yes. Well, so many great things about that. But the wonderful callback of, I'm taking these napkins and I'm not paying. And there's this incredible moment, like, really interesting persona-wise, just in your performance, because it started off like, I like coffee, I do all this thing, and the minute things went wrong, she was like a crazed beast. So that was a really fun transition, you know, and to see you really change over the course of it was really fun. Glenn. Oh yeah, I mean, the weird thing was so funny. There were so many fun, great things about that, and the pirate world, and that whole, the pirate store. But again, that thing of the parents dying and my parents dying really raised the stakes. It really, like, brought us in even more, you know? And it made those three words really matter so much. And I what a great ending, like, just be weird. And he's like, and that's what I've been doing. You know, like, that's what the advice I've been going on. That's also a great, you know, when you're doing a larger show, right? So say you want to do a longer, you want to do an hour-long show. You're like, how do I get all these stories together? Well, if they were all about, if this was the first story, you know, I like the first piece to be like an origin piece sometimes. Like, if you think of Batman, which is the origin story?
His parents
gunned down in front of him. What did that make him do?
Become Batman.
Yeah, become this, like, dark Avenger of the night and hate guns, right? So he has this thing, and it's like, just be weird. And I'm living that from now on, right? And so, like, we could see these continued adventures of the guy who's, like, destined to be weird. So you could have a series of stories, you know. A lot of us think of, like, you know, the way, you know, often we have stories about how we were born, you know. I came out, you know, I was supposed to come out after 9 months, it took 10, or whatever it is, you know, like, and it's like, I've been dragging my heels ever since. Like, that's a great kind of story that gets us going and provide a framework for a whole show. Samantha? Wonderful use of persona. As a 17-year-old, as a 17-year-old, right? Using, like, self-knowledge about something like that, like, it starts off with, like, as a 17-year-old, I don't know what I'm doing, but then it becomes using the fact that people would think I'm a 17-year-old, and then it winds up with this, like, twisted thing of, like, her rationalizing how I was going to steal. Like, this is what's wrong with children today. And a great persona of, like, the innocent-looking girl who's really the bad seed. Really, really fun. Really fun to see people do bad stuff, right? Yeah. You know, and that her realization is, I'm a criminal. Gloria. Again, I love, what a sense of history was the beginning. It all began when I was 11 years old. But beautiful. It's so hilarious with the don't be coy, these things happen. But wonderful sense. You know, what's great about having a longer life to write about is we see these large arcs, you know? And so to be able to, like, talk about this, like, passion you had for piano at that age and the obstacles she came up against, right? And first they were external, right? Which were her mother and her sister and her unbelievably, like, evil sister, right?
Right.
And then what were her obstacles? Were they always all external? So some of them became herself. And this is what often happens to us, right? You know, we wanted something early on, and somebody told us no, and then we take that voice and put it in ourselves. And we spend the rest of our life kind of like fighting that voice in ourselves. And wasn't it so sad? Like, the longer you didn't play the piano, the more satisfying it was for us when you did finally play the piano. Yeah. So it was very, and of course, what would be the end of this show? Yeah, the piano, like, she does the show, and then the curtain draws back, and there's this giant piano. She's on place. And then Juan. Well, we already talked a little bit about it, but, you know, in terms of, like, persona. But, you know, I know you feel afraid of doing this, but I think it took incredible courage to have your I Want song being I Want a Tina Howard. And really interesting, right? And it's like, I know it's scary to say that kind of stuff, but that's actually the kind of stuff that we're interested by. You know, saying that stuff that you don't tell other, that you don't tell other people because you think nobody else thinks that. Anybody else here was hoping that Tina Howard would like them? Right? Yeah. When this is the last thing I'm going to say, and then you guys can just talk or leave or whatever. The first show I did about my eating disorder, there's this thing in New York called Naked Angels. They have this company, and they do this thing called Tuesdays at 9, where it's like 150 people gather each Tuesday night at 9 o'clock at this theater, and 6 writers read excerpts of their work. And it's usually like 5 plays and then 1 solo show or essay or something. And I was literally my second time going, and they picked this piece for me to read. And Katie, we were talking about before, and it's very cool. You know, and it was even more cool this time. It was all these, like, big theater professionals in black, smoking, you know, stuff. And I was like, Katie, this was this sweet piece about me with my little eating disorder. And Katie was like, do not do that piece there. Like, this is not going to go. I love this piece. Do not do it. It's going to be dangerous. And I was like, I know. I just feel this need to do it. So I went up, and I was scared. Like, Kenneth Lonergan went before me, you know. So it was just like, oh, God. So then I got up, and I read my piece. And it went over really well. People were, like, laughing, and they were really moved, and it was nice. And then afterwards, you know, people came up to me and said, good job and stuff. And then everybody went away, and this young guy came up to me. And he was like 19, 20 years old, and he was like rail thin. And he said, thank you. And told my story. And he said, you know, I'm actually an intern in this company. They've been encouraging me to write, but I don't have the words. And tonight you gave me the words. So what you do when you do this show is you do it for the person who doesn't have the courage to say it. And the thing that I hope that this experience today gives you more courage that, like, what you have to say is interesting, and that you do have, your stories do have worth, you are enough, and that those petty problems you have are actually the interesting things that we want to hear about and hear how you deal with them. We want to know, like, what we do. That's what I want to know, is, like, what you have learned on your how you've been hurt, how you got through it, what you learned in your time on the planet. You don't have to be an expert for everybody, you just have to come from your heart and use these principles. Okay, so I hope that this was helpful to you guys. And,
thank you.